Cardboard Nation. It was one of those pre-show moments. Sorry about that. Thanks for tuning into the Hobbies Web Show tonight. Go GTS Live. I'm Rob Bertrand, your host. Ivan Lovgren joining me as always, having a bit of a laugh pre-show. How are you, brother?
A laugh at my expense. Here I am being right, and people are just laughing instead of taking it seriously. But I'm doing great, Rob. We're going to have some fun on the show tonight. Lots of great energy, lots of great discussion, lots of great debate. And we have an incredible guest coming on in just a few minutes. We are literally going to sit down and talk retail with Panini head of sales, DJ Kazmierczak. Did I pronounce that right?
Yeah.
Nice.
I think you nailed it.
Nice. So you do not want to go away. You want to retweet our pinned our broadcast tweet. You want to tag your friends. Let the cook groups know. This is the interview in 3 minutes of the year based on this week's news. And if you've missed that news, well, stay tuned.
We're going to get to it. Yeah, no doubt. We got a lot going on tonight. In addition to, I'm so glad you said DJ's last name, because now that it's been said once, now we just can refer to him as DJ. So
the intro to the interview.
No way. You already took care of it. So in addition to DJ, we've got a great poll question. Thanks to James Gale that we'll get to in just 1 second. Nearly 50 slide presentation for hobby happenings tonight. Lots going on. Box breaks from Tops and Upper Deck. Video segments with UFC's Michael Chandler talking Panini UFC Prism. Another video segment about a ticket stub super collector. Hot in the shop. Go GTS Live Q&A and a whole bunch more. But as always, we kick things off with the Go GTS Live Q of the Week poll, which is courtesy of James Gale, the asset. Where do you keep your ultimate high dollar value super mega? This is my hold. Ignore the typo. Hold for life collection.
Well, it's not a typo.
It's an intentional typo.
So, Rob, we've been talking about so much about crypto and NFT. So this typo, I don't know where it exactly popped up originally, but basically in the crypto space, that's what you say of somebody that's like they're holding, they're not selling when things go up and down. They're hodling.
See, I learned something on my own show.
So, yeah.
I love it. So, well, anyway, so where are you guys keeping those? Are they on display for all to see, stowed away in the dark someplace, offsite under lock and key, or other? 146
to dust.
People. I started doing that this week too. 146 people weighing in so far. Leading the way is stowed away in the dark. So a lot of people might have a safe, a lockbox, and a closet and binder, you know, whatnot. And then second place on display for all to see. I'm really surprised. Almost 10% offsite under lock and key. That surprised me a little bit that number was that high. I had to say on display for all to see. I mean, look around me for the most part. But in actuality, I do have a dozen or so cards that are also stowed away in the dark.
Well, so Rob, I kind of got wrestled with this one, because part of it was ultimate high dollar value super mega, which I don't have a whole ton of those, but I do have this thing that one of the jewel cases from Ultra Pro. I don't think they even make these anymore. Jewelry display cases, but four cards.
Do you know what Ivan? Do you know that the backdrop for our box breaks is taped to exactly one of those things you just showed?
Nice. So I've got some incredible things here. I've got an Ernie Banks autograph that was a gift from a friend, Todd Munson. I've got a Thurman Munson that was a gift from a friend, Eric. Those back pages. I've got a couple of Diego Rossi rookie cards. I've got the card that got its own mention in Beckett from Chris Bryant, from Mike in Vegas. EJ Bailey, a good friend, sent me this one of one. So these are my top PC cards for certain, including the card Kevin Gust made from Project 2020. So I have them on display for all to see. The only problem is it's facing me, not my monitor. So literally no one ever sees this because no one comes into my small private room here. But on the surface, they are on display for all to see.
What if we started a new weekly segment? What's in your safe? And we have a different collector on and they show us what's under lock and key.
I like that because I was like, mine would get boring after 1 week.
Well, I could do it. I mean, fun. I was going to say I could do it 1 week. You do it the 1 week so people see what we're talking about. And then the third week we'll have, you know, a guest collector on and show us.
I love that. I actually love that idea. Let's see if we can Skype in somebody for 5 minutes to show off four or five.
What's under lock and key?
Yeah.
All right.
Whether it's PC or value, it'll be fun to bring some more of you collectors onto our show. But basically, what Rob's not saying is we have a new setup that makes it so much easier to bring guests on with high quality.
I do want to read some of your all's... gosh, I try to avoid that. It's big in Ohio, you all, y'all. I want to read some of your responses to the question because I thought very insightful. Donnie R., who's at LilQuack1976 on Twitter, only have two cards in a locked fire safe. Both are graded 2015 Topps opening day Mike Trout variations. Rest of my cards are in the closet for anyone that wants to see. Fox Brain says it's in the attic of my parents' house. I hope the raccoons don't eat it. SS Gred 4, gun safe. Ivan, gun safe. We were just talking about that before we went on the air.
Yeah, I may actually be purchasing.
Because if you have a lot of stuff, you know, if you do have a firearm, if you have some precious metals, if you do have some cards that are under lock and key and they're in three different places, you're thinking of going the gun safe route to kind of consolidate, right?
Well, yeah, it's you know, I've got kids now, so there's some documents and things that need protecting too. Exactly. Also, we do live in an apartment. You know, you can get a smaller safe, but God forbid something happens in the apartment vandalism-wise, you can walk out with one of those. You can't walk out with one of these giant, takes up a whole corner safes, right? So, you know, those were my thoughts. We were having some fun before the show looking at one that I thought was, I don't know guns super well, so I was convinced it was had space for a bazooka launcher and a grenade store. I'm pretty sure those are for grenades. Rob was saying they're for people that have 10 pistols. I'm like, nobody has 10 pistols. Those have to be for grenades.
I think the number was six.
But then there's the other pouches. I don't know. Costco has an attractive looking one. Let's just put it that way. And I could think of, they're not exactly grenades, but I could think of a few Lewis Hamilton bombs I could put in those. So
there you go. There you go. Well, some of you other people said in my treasure chest, but my PC isn't worth more than a few bucks. I hear you. In a super secret location for security. Can't talk about it. I know. Then you'd have to kill me.
Wax, with those grenades from the gun safe.
Wax Ecstatic said, in the PWCC Marketplace Vault. It's one of the services they offer. Let's see. Little's around, so my safe for now. All right. From Ricky Hedrick, 23. And my house is close to being as secure as Fort Knox. Okay, this is from at FemDen. So graded sorting boxes in the office is good enough for me. Oh, there you go. Fair enough. So thank you for everybody that has weighed in. If you haven't, please do so. We'd love to hear from you, and we'll update the poll question later in the program.
Yeah, we only had 146 votes. So I know just from looking at the viewership numbers already that this could shift very strongly. So make sure you go to twitter.com/goGTSLive and vote in it because we'll come back to it. Also, you want to make sure that you go there and click follow if you have not already. If you're excited for the interview today and that's why you're watching this for the first time, make sure you follow us because we are ripping. Oh, gosh. How much money and stuff are we ripping today, Rob?
Almost $2,000. About $1,800. $1,800 bucks. Yeah.
And we're giving away the hits from that.
Yes.
On Twitter. So you have to engage on Twitter and follow on Twitter. We'll cover that later, but just make sure you check that out.
It was going to be more, but FedEx in Texas screwed up. Tracy did his job, and we talked yesterday, and package out the door of FedEx, whatever. So we're having DJ on, DJ Kazmierczak, VP of Product Development and Sales over at Panini America, and was really hoping to have some Panini product to break later, but I guess it'll be a Panini Palooza next week. How are you, DJ? Welcome back to Go GTS Live, my friend.
Well, what's up, fellas? You know, I've been wondering all day why I'm on tonight. I mean, what's going on? Why am I on the show?
Why could DJ be on the show tonight?
We're here to talk about blockchain, right?
There's a lot to talk about.
Well, let's dive right into the topic at hand, and it really is the topic. Lots of rumors, lots of absolute lies and falsehoods about retail. Some growing concerns from a public safety standpoint. So now Target is temporarily suspending sales of key trading card products. DJ, what's going on? We kind of talked about this a while back, but it's kind of at, I mean, I don't want to use the word crisis, but something's got to change. So what's going on? What's going to change?
Yeah. So what has happened is there's obviously been a lot of activity and Target has had a little bit more activity, let's say, than other retailers. And by activity, I mean people not getting along either in the stores or in the parking lot of the stores. And there was a specific incident last week in Milwaukee, and you can Google it and see what happened, but it led to the closure of a shopping center, the whole surrounding area, for about an hour. And clearly that's not something anybody wants to have happen. So on Monday, Target made a decision, and I know this because I've spoken to the buyer directly. So I want to make sure that I clarify my sources, because some people on social media don't seem to think that I am aware of what Target might be doing, or I'm just guessing. But in this instance, they've told me what their intention is, and they wanted to take a momentary pause. And how long a momentary pause is not defined. So I want to be clear. I'm not saying it's going to be 1 week, but I don't have any reason to believe that it's going to be for an extended period of time. And there's four areas in trading card area that are affected, and that is the baseball category, the football category, the basketball category, and the Pokemon category, of all things. And so the other trading cards, whether it be NASCAR, UFC, soccer, pick something else, they're going to be available in store when there is supply stock, if you will. So It's a temporary stoppage of in-store selling. Their plan is to try to sell a product online. We're still discussing how that works and how Excel, the category manager, supports that. And there's a number of things we still got to work through. But the bottom line to answer your question, Rob, right now is that they want to reset. They want to rethink and relook at the trading card space because they want a better customer experience for their customer. They are committed long-term to the category. I mean, they've been involved in trading cards for 20-plus years, and they've always had that 24 feet of dedicated space. While other retailers have come in, out, or truncated and expanded their space, Target has always had that 24 feet of space. Sometimes it was 16 feet entertainment, 8 sports. Sometimes it was 12-12. Sometimes it was 16 sports. You get my drift. So they've been a very valuable partner to our category. So I believe that we and I owe it to them to give them the time that they need to reassess the situation. I hope they come to a good, comfortable decision where I've provided them some thoughts and some things. So we're having some dialogue back and forth, but that's simply what's happening. And now as an extension, let me just tag before we have a conversation about it, that Walmart has not made any decision like this. Walmart has done nothing. Okay. So I saw some things where some stories out of a gaming blog or website out of the UK said that both Walmart and Target had discontinued. Now, I think Walmart, there has been individual stores where a manager may have made a decision, and that does happen. But corporate-wise, Walmart is all in on trading cards. I have a call Monday morning with the DMM and the buyer to continue discussions about future plans and what we're doing. So Walmart is staying the course the way it is now, if that is, if things stay the same.
All right. Now, let me ask you something, Ivan. I'm sorry. I'm going to forget to ask this if I don't do it now.
Yeah, go ahead.
I want to be... No, let's put it this way. Can you answer some of the questions you've received on social media that other people have asked, that other collectors have seen, that include things that maybe Panini could have done before this point, and some things that have been suggested? Raise the price, change the value equation. You know, silver prisms shouldn't be that cheap. And that's why we're having this, all this fiasco. Yep. Can you address those two things in particular?
Yeah. First of all, raising prices, that's been done. It just hasn't shown up at retail shelves yet because it takes, 3 to 4 months for it to happen. But come September, you will see increased retails. We are increasing retails in some instances, almost 50%. Some box blasters, particularly Optichrome. So you're talking about Prism, et cetera. Instead of the box blasters now being a $20 SRP, they're going to be a $29.99 SRP. And we've increased all the prices, but it lags. So that's one of those where, absolutely raising price. Now, somebody can come back and say, well, they're trading for or selling for, in some cases, $50-$60. You should go all the way up there to take the margin out of the middle. If I do that, then any casual consumer that's coming in that does encounter the product is probably not going to sample a product at that higher price. So there's got to be a bit of a compromise in terms of that. And then as far as value equations, this is one of those things where, and I don't want to sound how it could be interpreted, cocky or something, but you can't have it both ways. Okay. You can't have it both ways. If you want singles that are booking for what they are and trading for what they are, it's because box prices are where they're at. And then again, if the box prices aren't, if the demand is not where it is, which causes the box prices to rise, then people don't want the product. There are a lot of the reason people want to participate now is because it's the thing to do. So it's kind of hard to jockey that, but we build product the way we build product. We can't, that's like asking a home run hitter to go up and bunt. We just don't do it. We build it the way we build it.
So, I love it. Okay.
Yeah. No, I mean, it's like tell a product guy, just make an average product. That's just not the way they're wired.
I love it. That's honest. Ivan, I know you've got questions. Go ahead, brother.
I did, but that was so interesting to me to hear that I literally blanked. I did what you were worried you were going to do.
When you think of it, Ivan, just jump back in when you think of it. That's fine.
One of one. No, just kidding. So that is interesting because people always, ask that question. And I think that they miss the lead time that comes into these things. So sometimes feedback from 6 months ago, you do institute, but it still takes some time because your buyers may have bought a product at a previous purchase point. You can't just raise that price on them. What other kinds of things? This is your chance to educate us, the average collector, a little bit on the things that do grind us, but it's the process that makes it happen. It's not like there's an easy solution. Like what else is out there behind the scenes that we don't see?
Well, Well, the first thing I want everybody to know is that our distribution partners are honest people. Okay, that's the one thing I think that kind of grates on my nerves a little bit, if I have to really be honest about some of the things I read and stuff, right? They accuse distributors, whether they're hobby distributors like GTS or whether they're retail partners like an XL Marketing that services Target or MJH who services Walmart, and we work with other distributors. Fanatics is another example. People like the rail on Fanatics. I'm not going to do business with somebody that I don't trust and I don't see as a good business partner, and that they offer something and they add value as a distributor. So first of all our distributors are important to me because I think they add value to the distribution chain. And second of all, I'm not going to get into numbers because that's, you know, the numbers in this industry, when you put a number out, Rob might look at a number and go, oh, yeah, that's a reasonable number. Ivan might look at a number and go, whoa, that's a big number. What are you doing? So I don't like to talk in numbers because it's perception, right? But, I mean, we're moving a lot of product. I'll just be honest with you. I mean, look how many brands we have. We have 150 brands. Releases in a year across, you know, our multiple sports, 8-9 sports that we do. Tops is releasing quite a bit of product as well, right? So there's a lot of product to move through the channel. So it's one of those things where I don't like the criticism that the category managers have not done a good job here. Has there been a rep or two that has called a friend and said, hey, I'm going to the store now? Yeah, that's happened. Yeah. And when it has happened and we could prove it, we've pointed it out to whichever outfit they belong to. And in some cases, those people, unfortunately, have lost their job. Fortunately, that hasn't happened a lot. Usually there's a retraining and that stuff stops. But there's a lot of things that happen because we ship product, obviously, in cases to them. And cases, in the case of blasters, is 20 units in a case and on down the line. And that stuff has to be unboxed, you know, sent then to multiple stores. In Walmart's case, almost 4,000 stores. You know, Target's case, 1,800 stores. So there's a lot of work that goes in there. So there is a lot of value that the distributors add. They're also our eyes and ears to what's going on at retail. I do have a direct communication with both buyers now, the Target buyer and the Walmart buyer. So I do have chances to talk directly to them. But most of the time, we are talking to the category managers. That's where our information is coming from, and that's where the feedback is coming from. Quite frankly, that's where we first got alerted last year that when I go in to service a store now, I have an audience, right? That didn't happen before. And they would say, we got an audience. And so we're trying to figure out, you know, different ways. We talk to them and they change their service pattern. In the case of MJH, they reversed the order of stores they were doing. They actually started servicing overnight when the stores were closed, because for a while, Walmart was actually closing stores at night. I think now that a lot of states are opening up, they may be going back to that 24-hour thing they used to do. But they were doing overnight service. And, you know, I think the difference between the two chains was, you know, you had appointment buying at Target is where they eventually ended up. Fridays, you know, we're going to sell the product. Walmart never did that. And I think that makes a difference. It's just my honest opinion. I think people know it's there on one day. They're going to line up, queue up. It's like getting in line for concert tickets or something, right? Yeah. And whereas the other way, it's not. You're trickling people in. And yes, you may have some times when you got some guys sitting in chairs in an aisle waiting for somebody, but I don't know. So those were some of the things that go on behind the scenes in terms of that. But I mean, I trust, I want to be clear about this. I trust all of our distribution partners or they wouldn't be working with us.
Well, so that it reminded me actually of the question, and it's a little bit of positive feedback too. One of the strongest reactions I've seen to the news these past 2 days has been a number of collectors who say, oh no, the past few weeks has been the first time I've been able to get retail.
Yeah.
So I don't know if you're seeing as much positive, because I know how much you get hammered. So I wanted to share that I've seen a lot of collectors that do say the one pack or the one item works for them. I've also always been curious if that works though for a big box retailer to spend that much time and attention monitoring sports cards. Where's that balance?
Yeah, my concern was when Target went to the program, my concern was, and we've had some inconsistent shipping because of that week we lost back in the middle of February to Icemageddon down here when we didn't have power for a week, and our printer is here, and they lost basically 7 business days of printing time. So we've been kind of playing catch up since then. So our shipping schedule has been a little ragged, if you will. And so there's been some weeks where we haven't shipped the normal amount of product that we would, you know, into store. So it's been inconsistent in that regard as far as what's available to people. But, you know, I read those comments as well about people. And so my concern was that when we get to a week where we've got 10 trucks going to Excel instead of 3 or 4, because we're making up for the weeks where we were soft, could they get through the inventory in one day? Because they're selling it one day, then they're stopping for a week and then selling again. So I was worried if it would, you know, just pile up and then they couldn't catch up. So that was my concern. Now, obviously now with this, I mean, we'll have to see and what happens with the reset, but that was my concern. But I read a lot of the same things. Listen, you guys know me, you've known me for a while. I'm always a glass half full guy, right? And this is one of those things where unfortunately there's not a perfect solution to this. If we made it so that, you know, the product wasn't desirable or less desirable, then eventually most everybody wouldn't want to participate in it very much. This is just a classic supply and demand challenge. Call it capitalism, but that's what's going on here. And the supply far, the demand far outweighs the supply. And you guys know we're capped to a certain extent on how much we can make for a lot of reasons. One, we're in the collectibles business, so we're not supposed to make a ton of stuff. But two, autographs are not infinite, and game worn's not infinite, right? So there are some variables that cap us as to where we can go in terms of production anyway. So right now, I'm telling you, I could make 50% more product and nobody would notice. I can't because I just don't have the assets to do it.
Let me circle back to something that you mentioned at the beginning. And I think this comes back to solutions. What happens after this pause, this reset, or whatever?
Yep.
You mentioned selling online. And yeah. I know the minute you said that, hundreds of viewers went, bots.
Yep.
Okay, help us understand. You know, obviously Target can do whatever they want. They can say, you know what, we're going to put it all online and that's it and be done with it. Someone can whisper to them and go, hey, have you heard about these bots things? It's really going to end up being the same thing, but only online. And they go, I don't care. I'm done with this.
Yeah.
And what conversations do you, the category manager, and the buyer have collectively to say, okay, if that's going to be part of the solution, what are you guys going to do to prevent a bot problem?
Yep. I've had that conversation with Fanatics. I can tell you that because they obviously, we make some exclusive product for them. We make exclusive SKUs for them on occasion, and they've been ravaged by bots when that happens. And so I've had lots of conversations about what they're doing. And again, you can soften the blow from bots. You can't totally eliminate them. People are rewriting code all the time and that sort of thing. But yeah, that's one of my concerns here is that if Target's strategy, at least for a couple of weeks, is to try to sell the equivalent amount of product they would sell in store online, I do have concerns. I'll be honest with you that it will be bot heaven for them. And the problem is they've already had one instance where they put up one of our products. I don't remember which one it was, but it really doesn't matter. And their site became unstable because they got hammered pretty hard. And you're talking about Target.com. We made Target.com unstable, and that's not a good thing either. So there are constant conversations. Every organization handles it differently. Obviously, when we started doing Dutch auctions for our first off the line, one of the reasons we did Dutch auctions is because we start at outrageously high prices and everybody goes, they're crazy, they're never going to sell. Yeah, we do that because in case somebody wants to bot us, they end up buying product, a lot of it, at a crazy high price, and that's, they'll learn their lesson. They won't bot us next time. So that's one of the reasons that we went to that structure. I know everybody thinks we're just greedy. I hear that all the time. And, you know, so that's, that was one of the ways we thought we could slow the bot activity down, and it has worked.
Very good. Well, listen, I think, I hope you got accomplished what you wanted to, because I'm pretty sure we got accomplished what we wanted to for the collectors. I think that really kind of sums it up, addresses some of the misnomers that were out there, and we look forward to talking about continued solutions. And hey, yeah.
And I read, listen, you know, I don't always respond, because quite frankly, some of the stuff I read is just completely untruthful. I don't know if people, a lot of people might not know, Rob does. I was a television journalist at the beginning of my career for 10 years. And what the media has become now in terms of accuracy, it just drives me crazy. I saw some things today from reputable sources where they were incorrect about what's going on. So I just want everybody to know that I do read what people post. I see the ideas. I see all the different viewpoints. And listen, everybody is passionate about the industry, and I appreciate that. And we're going to work as hard as we can to come up with better solutions. We're still working on the Kids Crate program I talked about last time I was on the show. That's imminent. We are not dismissing this. I know a lot of people think we don't care. We do care, but that's not really an easy answer or solution.
There it is, man. I love it. DJ, always succinct, to the point, and on target. You're welcome back anytime. You know that. Appreciate you, sir.
Absolutely. You guys have a good night.
You too. Bye-bye, you too. DJ.
Bye.
Great stuff. Lot of good information there. And you learned something. Because there's a lot of moving components. I didn't even think about the delay of rollouts after decisions are made. Ivan, that was a great point that you elaborated on with DJ for sure.
Me too, because I think it was about 4 or 5 months ago we had DJ on to talk about retail, and that was one of our suggestions.
Yep.
Was like, let's be honest, the part of the demand, it's not, I don't know if it's a problem or not, is that you have a better chance. You have like a 5 times better chance of getting a silver prism in a blaster now for the price than you do in a hobby box. Like, that's part of what's going on. Like, no wonder I'm chasing prism blasters left and right too, because a hobby box is $1,000. The market has set that. And yet I have I'll get a silver prism rookie from a blaster. Well, yeah, I'd so much rather buy, what is that? 50 blasters for the price of one hobby box. Right?
At least. Like,
yeah. So, so very great from DJ. Lots of cool stuff there. I do want to just throw out, because I saw it in one chat and I'm guessing it was in the others. Yeah, lots of questions. Blockchain, the Kids Crate program, even the hashtag question. Basically, we just didn't have enough time. We knew that we had 20 minutes or less with DJ, so it was all about retail tonight, but we will try our best to get him back on, because he's great to talk to. He doesn't hide things,
Yeah.
So
love it. Absolutely love it. All right. Well, we got. Yeah.
I mean, I see Pabst Beer 8 in our chat.
Yeah, he could definitely handle it. Everybody heard that, right, James?
Oh.
Okay, can you repeat that?
They got to watch us listen.
That's important.
The voice from God.
We had a troll in the Twitch chat. That's the only chat I have the energy and ability to watch while doing the show. And I removed some of their messages. They have not returned, but I put them on timeout. And so we're going to make Pabst Beer a moderator. If he posts in the chat and says, I'm up to the challenge.
Very cool. Very cool.
I would hope so.
Yeah. Sorry, guys. I got to make a quick note there. Okay. All right.
Same thing. I was like, don't start yet. I forgot to get my script up.
It's just a lot of moving pieces tonight. And yeah, don't be a troll.
Yeah.
Glad you caught that. Oh, so as we are waiting to take a look at some hobby happenings, just to kind of recap a little bit more on DJ's conversation, we'll wait to hear from James in my ear that we're ready to go. But, you know, he has been around a long time. He's done this, and he does have a lot of the answers, and he's also open and willing to try new things. And so knowing that him, the category manager, and the buyer at Big Box are all involved in looking at solutions, hopefully they get this worked out. Ultimately, at the end of the day, like I was kind of alluding to, it's ultimately the store's decision. And hopefully they do the right thing when it comes to investing in IT to fight bots if they're going to move a chunk of their business online. Now, the only problem with that is it still really it defeats the whole purpose that DJ was alluding to of those first time and buyer experiences at retail, you know, that entry level. And so I hope that they're able to keep product around in some capacity, because you want it to be accessible, bottom line. So, but yeah, we've got a lot going on. We aggregate it all in a weekly segment that we like to call Hobby Happenings, news, notes, and nuggets from around the web about this hobby you know and love. Well, this right here is the football that Tom Brady threw to complete his first touchdown pass in the NFL. And it's selling for over $105,000 through Leland's Auctions in extended bidding tonight. Wow. It's a unique piece of sports history that has been with the seller, who wished to remain anonymous, since the game on October 14th, 2001. That day, the New England Patriots played the San Diego Chargers, with Brady leading the team to a 29-26 overtime thriller. That year, the team went 11-5, completely flipping the script from the previous season's 5-11 record. And Brady's first taste of NFL on-field success was made with this ball. Very cool.
You got to wonder if Tom himself isn't bidding on that.
No doubt.
Bloomberg reports that a new sports memorabilia show with Golden Auctions is currently in the works. Sports Collectors Daily had the full details, including the fact that one of the people spearheading the Golden Show is none other than Brent Montgomery, who was the executive producer of a previous sports memorabilia reality TV show some of you might remember, Ball Boys. He was also a driving force behind the runway hit Pawn Stars. 2 years later, Montgomery eventually sold his company, Left Field Pictures, and he's now the CEO of Wheelhouse Entertainment, which has produced a large number of entertainment shows. Bloomberg sources indicate Montgomery has partnered with former ESPN 30 for 30 producer Connor Schell, who recently started his own production company with financing from, get this, the Chernin Group. Yep. If you've been paying attention to all the cogs and behind the scenes workings, that is the same firm which recently poured $40 million into Golden Auctions. See how that all works?
Mm-hmm. Now, Ivan, do you remember that show Ball Boys from that last story?
Oh, you got to put me on the hot seat here, huh?
Well, it's okay if you don't. I do. I caught every episode. Well, to give everyone a taste of what the flavor of the show was all about, watch this. It's pretty cool.
Every great moment in sports leaves something behind. I'm Robbie Senior. My son Junior and I have been buying and selling sports history for over 20 years.
It's a 1927 scorecard. You recognize this name?
Babe Ruth.
That's awesome.
If it'll make us cash, we're going to buy it. If it's rare, we're going to find it.
This bat is Jackie Robinson.
Wilt Chamberlain, like, this is cool. I'm wearing his coat.
One of the greatest things about being here is you never know what's going to come through that door.
Original 1938.
Tiger Stadium turns out.
This is grass from famed Cleveland Municipal Stadium.
1944 Philadelphia Eagles.
Is that the Clark Gable?
What position did he play on that team?
The atmosphere in my store, it's kind of like a barbershop.
I got you.
Hey, how old are you?
Look at that.
My dad has endless connections in the sports world.
Senior, hello.
Hey, what's up with you, buddy?
I didn't come in here, you know, for no $600.
You got any of my autographs in here?
Of course I do.
I see Johnny Bench's shirt. What's up with that?
You can come in and talk sports all day long.
There's going to be another Jordan.
Now, that's where we disagree. Let me tell everybody what makes Michael Jordan the greatest of all time.
The PH is just a make-believe position.
So I just make-believe Eddie Murray hit this 500 home run.
Oh, no, he hit it. He hit it, okay. But I guarantee you, he wouldn't have hit it if he had to be a regular player.
Arguing my dad is like playing for the Astros. No matter what you do, you're never going to win.
It's a knockoff. I'd never buy this thing.
It's my store. If I see something I like, I buy it.
I'm not going to let you make a profit of $350 or double your money. That's insulting to me.
What are you looking for?
Thinking like $5,000.
Who? I'm looking at $5,700, $5,800.
You got to be tripping.
Come on now.
When it comes to sports history, we ain't playing around.
Vince Lombardi's cleats.
Wow. How in the world did you get a World Series trophy?
I would value it at $15,000 to $20,000. It belongs in the Green Bay Packer Hall of Fame.
Sound like we got a deal.
You got a deal.
It's unbelievable. Thank you so much.
This scrapbook was done by two kids in the early part of the 20th century.
This, to me, is the most impressive piece of sports memorabilia I've ever seen.
These are the actual hoops used in Madison Square Garden for the New York Knicks.
Let's get it.
I would say that this thing is worth probably over $2 million.
We are the Ball Boys.
So, yeah, really cool show. I mean, just kick back, watch guys hang out with famous athletes, make buys at a store. It's a great shop. So anyway, you can find episodes online. So be sure to check it out if you're interested.
Yeah. To fill that gap until this new show on the hobby debuts.
Exactly.
Looks good. Everyone knows soccer is huge right now in the collecting world. And Topps Match Attacks, you might be surprised to find out, it's not just a game. That's right. Topps has a new product, Match Attacks Extra 2020-2021, which features 284 cards with the latest squad updates, club captains, 100 club, new time to shine, position switch cards, and more. So check out this awesome commercial Topps produced to promote soccer cards even more.
Match Attacks Extra. It's crunch time in the season. Calling all ballers, tricksters, and match winners. Step up and collect the biggest superstars from Europe's best clubs. The time is now. New cards, new ratings, plus real autograph cards. Match Attacks Extra. Out now.
So, I don't know if you guys have seen this, and I know they've been doing it for a while now, but I wanted to make sure it was actually going to be a regular thing before reporting on it. So Fanatics does these signings called Fanatics Live, and it's basically a fan interactive Zoom call with a featured athlete who then proceeds to do a live and engaging Q&A with the fans while signing items for Fanatics. I think this is really, really cool. CC Sabathia was a recent guest. He was great. And the easiest way to catch the next event is just to follow Fanatics on Twitter. These have been fun to watch. Highly recommend it.
If I can add a plug on there, a few weeks back, Chipper Jones was on, and our friend Jimmy Mahan at Kentucky Cards and three or four other collectors from the Twitter world were on with Chipper. So
see, that's awesome. I love
check
it.
Out the CC, check out the Chipper. It's a really cool new program from Fanatics. This next story, I am so pumped to share. I even teased it on Twitter earlier today because this is awesome. A rare, great story from TMZ. You'll be surprised to read a positive one. They wrote, Wayne Gretzky is not only the great one on the ice, but clearly off of it too. Because the NHL legend made a fan's life by re-autographing a rather unique item. And the story is awesome. Back in 1986, a little boy and his mother ran into Gretzky, But they had one problem. They had no hockey memorabilia for Wayne to sign. We've all been there, right? So mom thought quickly on her feet, handed over her little boy's Nike shoe, and Gretzky gladly slapped his John Hancock on it. The piece actually came out pretty cool. It's a baby shoe with Wayne Gretzky's signature on it. But 30 plus years later, the signature faded, and the boy who had kept it all that time was heartbroken. So much so, he says he tried everything he could to get in touch with Gretzky to have him re-sign the shoe. Fortunately, after years of reaching out, he posted his story on a Facebook group's page. So, A, social media works, collector groups work. And get this, the team over at Upper Deck eventually caught wind of it and decided to jump in with a helping hand. Upper Deck was able to ultimately get the shoe in front of Gretzky. And after explaining to him the story of it all, the great one gladly signed it again. The piece is now truly incredible, especially because Gretzky wrote one of one on it alongside his signature. And Upper Deck went the extra mile and authenticated it, as well as sent it back to the fan, who couldn't have been more grateful. Quote, I can't thank everyone enough that helped get this done, the fan said. This shoe will remain in my family forever. If I thought it was priceless before, it has now become even more priceless, if that's possible. That's, incredible story.
That is so awesome.
Awesome.
I'm jealous
job
you got to read it. It was awesome.
It's so cool.
Goosebumps. Meet Paul Jones, a.k.a. Foul Ball Paul. The man with the most baseball cards on planet Earth, and it isn't even close. This week, MLB.com showcased Paul in a feature article about his 3 million plus card collection. Many of you might recognize Paul from either the National, Hobby Magazine cover appearances, social media, subject in Jack of All Trades, the movie, but it's the story of how he got started collecting that I really loved about this article. I guess the story goes that while 9-year-old Paul was attending a local AAA Las Vegas Stars game, his dad bought him a team set of cards, brought Paul down to the railing where the other kids were begging players for autographs. But Paul, who is autistic, had just begun talking more and more recently, but fell silent. He stood there more like a statue, as his father Barry described. Players walk by and they're looking at him because they're waiting for, can I get an autograph? Barry said. And so what happens is the manager walks by, Tim Flannery, and he turns to Paul and he says, hey, would you like my autograph? And Paulie nods his head. Tim takes his cards and he finds his card and he signs it, and he looks at the other card, sees they're not signed, turns to him and says, hey, would you like to go into the locker room and get the rest of the card signed? Well, duh. Paul looked back smiling at his dad, who was of course saying, go, go. Paul walked with Flannery into the player clubhouse, had all of his cards signed, and almost immediately developed a love affair with baseball and baseball card collecting. There's a lot more to the article. It'll bring a smile to your face. Be sure to read the full article for yourself.
That's absolutely incredible. How am I supposed to talk about cards and money after that? But that's why this hobby is so special and so fun, is that they can all come together. ESPN ran an article on cards this week titled, on sports memorabilia, titled Inside the Mysterious World of Missing Sports Memorabilia. And with several well-known industry experts, they spoke to come up with this list of the top six missing pieces of sports memorabilia seemingly lost to history. Starting with that Tom Brady starting with the chip shots seen around the world. 50 years ago on the moon, Alan Shepard hit two of the most watched golf shots ever. And of course, those golf balls are still there somewhere waiting for Elon. On April 15th, 1947, Jackie Robinson made his MLB debut at Ebbets Field in Brooklyn, New York. When Robinson stepped up to the plate that day, he became the first black player in Major League Baseball history, thus paving the way for decades of incredible athletes and players to come. But the jersey he wore in front of 26,000 plus people is missing to this day. Bobby Thompson's 1951 home run remains one of the most famous walk-offs in Major League Baseball history. His bat, glove, and cleats reside in Cooperstown, but arguably baseball's most hallowed piece of rawhide has yet to be found, despite many people claiming to possess the treasure through the years. And then there's this ball. In the bottom of the ninth, in Game 1 of the 1988 World Series, Kirk Gibson looked more likely to collapse in the batter's box than craft a timeless Los Angeles and baseball sports moment, especially against A's closer Dennis Eckersley, who hadn't allowed a home run since late August that year. Then, as Vin Scully famously crooned, the impossible has happened. That famed ball, however, is still missing today. This next piece, if it ever existed, would be worth a fortune. Shoeless Joe Jackson's stolen alleged confession to his role in fixing the 1919 World Series has never seen the light of day. Might be hanging out somewhere with Jimmy Hoffa, but can you imagine finding that?
It doesn't exist. He never confessed.
A White Sox fan wrote this piece. In April 2000, finally, when Kerry Ryman sold Wilt Chamberlain's 100-point ball for more than $550,000 at an auction, it caused quite a stir. It was the world's most expensive basketball and one of the loftiest sports tokens ever sold. And then the sale was nullified a month later over questions of authenticity. The ball has never been found. It's crazy.
Good stuff. And if you want to find that article on ESPN, they talk about how much those things might be worth. Pretty interesting. Last week, we told you about the Green Bay Packers' A.J. Dillon streaming live on the Loop app last weekend. Well, what happens when Dillon pulls his own card? Watch this.
No way. I'm going to save this one for the end. Oh, man. All right. We got an Alex Smith. And then I don't know if I can autograph this. There's already an autograph on it. That's fire. We got an A.J. Dillon, out of 99, 25 out of 99 out of select. It's up to you. Do you want me to double auto it? Rides, I can auto the back, or you can sign the patch. All right, I think this one's too thick, so either black or gold. Which one do you want, Rye? Gold, bet. That's fire. That is sick. All right, Rye with the first ever AJ Dillon pulled on Dillon's deals. First select double auto as well in the world. That's fire. That's sick.
This has been a fun show.
I mean, that's not even us. That's AJ Dillon just doing what we all as collectors know. Want.
He seems like you could just hang out with the guy, you know?
I mean, not only that, but I've been saying for years, when like the tip of the marketing iceberg has not even been hit in the hobby, like that's the tip of it, finally.
Right.
Right. Incredible job, Loop, making that happen. Awesome of you, AJ Dillon, to be a collector yourself and an athlete and do that. Just fantastic. Fantastic. So no surprise, Michael Jordan, he's been retired for a while, but he keeps breaking records. This is the only known Michael Jordan game-worn North Carolina Tar Heels basketball jersey, and it sold for an astonishing $1.38 million last Saturday with Heritage Auctions. Chris Ivey, Heritage's director of sports auctions, said in a statement, quote, "Over the last year, Heritage has set dozens of world records in the red-hot Michael Jordan collectibles market, and now we're extremely proud to have shattered the records for a Jordan game-worn jersey." Shattered? Whoa. So what was the previous record price paid for a Jordan game-worn jersey? $480,000. That's a $900,000 difference, right? And according to Sports Collectors Daily, that previous sale was an MJ game-worn Bulls uniform from the 1986-87 season, which sold just last October in a, get this, Heritage auction sale. So is it really bragging if you beat your own record?
Yeah.
Congrats, like Heritage.
Like 480, I mean, almost three times. It's crazy. Speaking of Heritage, they had another big weekend, even aside from the record-breaking Jordan jersey. The 1909-11 T206 Honus Wagner card graded a PSA 1.5, net nearly $2.3 million, establishing a new high mark for any Wagner T206 graded below a 3. And the second highest selling item in the auction was one of the modern card hobby's hottest issues, a 2000 playoff contenders Tom Brady championship ticket. It's numbered 34 of 100, graded 8.5 by BGS with a 10 autograph grade. It went for nearly $1.6 million.
Crazy. Sports Collectors Daily reports that after being inundated with orders earlier this spring after PSA suspended most of their services, SGC raised the base rate for trading card authentication and grading from $25 to $75 per card. However, if you fast forward a little over 5 weeks, SGC is now saying that they're not only caught up, but have lowered the cost back down to $30 per card with a turnaround time of 20 to 25 business days. So see, it does happen.
Yeah. Hey, Ivan. Psst. Look at this.
What is
yeah. It? That's right, my friend. Onyx Vintage Collection Basketball is coming this summer. Stay tuned for more details, man. Our guy Lance Fisher and Onyx are on fire lately.
It's crazy that it's hitting me right now. Why was no one doing that sooner? We'll talk about that after the segment because we've still got some good big news. Get this, collectible app CEO and former Go GTS Live guest Ezra Levine was a guest on Barstool Sports this week. So he's going down a bit in his shows, but that's okay. We'll forgive him. Spreading the hobby message to the mainstream. Here's a quick clip from that Barstool Sports interview.
Is this a brag or is it a good investment or is it both? Or is it too soon to tell?
So, you know, look, we always say this is the perfect intersection of passion and profits. We say okay. That all the time, right?
Okay.
Again, you know, I try to be very careful with my words, right?
So yeah.
There's no guarantee of future returns.
Sure. Disclaimers, let's go.
All that good stuff. Historically speaking, I'll speak historically, right, because that's factual. There are a couple indices which suggest that high-end sports collectibles have dramatically outcomped more traditional investments like the stock market. There's one index which suggests since 2008, the high-end sports card market has outperformed stocks by 500%. 500%.
All right. And now three different hobby-related crime stories. And this is getting ridiculous, but thanks to Sports Collectors Daily for keeping on top of all this. So first up, as alluded to by DJ earlier this evening, a dispute between five men over the weekly distribution of retail boxes at a Milwaukee area Target erupted into a fight outside the store. that's when one man who was on the receiving end of the assault pulled a gun, according to reports by multiple Milwaukee media outlets. Police were called, where they learned a 35-year-old man was attacked by four men who ranged from 23 to 35 years old. During the assault, the victim, who held a concealed carry permit, took out his weapon and pointed it at the attackers, who then left. They were arrested soon afterwards. So good on the Second Amendment there. Next, a suspected sports card thief was tasered after running away from police officers at an antique mall in Wildwood, Florida.
What amendment is that?
Police were summoned because the individual was suspected in the previous theft of baseball cards, according to a repressed report from the Wildwood Police Department. And then, in another hobby-related smash and grab, police seek clues in an Alabama hobby shop heist where the thief escaped with over $10,000 in unopened sports card product. So, guys, come on. It's just cardboard. Stop it. And, oh, great. Now look what you did. And, yep. As we know, this has been confirmed. Effective nationally, the Target will pause sales of popular trading card boxes starting tomorrow. And that's a look at this week's hobby happenings. Wow.
It's not worth going to jail over.
No, it's not worth going to jail. That's sage advice from Ivan. It's not worth going to jail over.
If you're trying to profit in the hobby and that's your only option, DM me. I have a job for you. Like, I can help you make money and not go to jail, all right? Like, let's talk. It's not that hard. So that said, absolutely crazy. Lots of crazy news. Rob, actually, can I tease that other story while we get queued up for the other one? I know I talked about next week, but it actually goes hand in hand with
it. Piece. Something that got slightly left off of hobby happenings was a Sun Times article that I knew Ivan would enjoy. Ivan, please share it with the audience.
So again, local articles don't always get all the national play they deserve, but in one of those summaries of all the Cubs news for the day on May 9th, Jared Wiles for the Sun-Times reports that Jake Marisnyk has introduced the hobby to his teammates in the Chicago Cubs clubhouse.
I love it.
You know, that, and then David Ross, the manager, is quoted as saying they're into some of the new basketball cards, baseball cards, collecting those, opening up packages. Everybody's around. It's like a huge ordeal when somebody gets a new box and you're going through it. Like, so imagine, like, these are still humans. These are still guys. They're still dudes. They're still, you know, young guys now. Gosh, I'm older than most of the baseball players on the team. So they get excited too. It's going on in clubhouses. And that's what I'm talking about. For years, I've been saying it. And then when Gary V came in and people said, oh, the hobby's too inflated, it's too crazy, I can still name 20 friends in my cell phone who are not yet collecting. But more and more people are getting back into it. The money is one thing, but it also means that it gets attention, which means a Jake Marisnyk may walk into the dugout and then him and Anthony Rizzo and David Ross are talking about it. You know, like, that's more money deal. And more that's attention into the deal. Hobby. And yeah, you know, how much would you like to see Anthony Rizzo breaking cards like that? You know,
absolutely.
Or name your favorite player here. So super, super, super fun.
All right. So let's dive into our live box break segment for this evening. And we're going to kick it off with a product that we were excited to hear about when it was solicited. Didn't know if we'd actually get our hands on it because in that interview with Mike Phillips, you know, we talked about how supply is not going to hit even close to demand on this. And that was reflected by its $1,000 release price.
Yeah. I was just going to ask Rob, the last time that Artifacts of Golf came out, what was the MSRP then? What was it selling for then?
Actually, the last time there's never been an Artifacts golf product. So it's a hard comparison, but it was the last golf product wasn't anywhere near what this is.
Well, I know in 2014 they had a golf product that was a little more chunky. That's how I describe something like this. And I think it was like what, $80 maybe?
Yeah, that sounds about right.
So demand is through the roof. Some of the sport's biggest names, men and women, present and past, including 10 of the top 35 in the world on the men's checklist right now. Number 3, Justin Thomas. Number 6, Bryson DeChambeau. Matthew Wolf and Colin Murakawa. Danielle Kang on the women's checklist, who's number 4
beefy
right now.
eBay 101. Number 25 of 25 on card auto of Luke List with a dual patch. 25 of 25.
Right out of the gate. Wow. Autograph patch. That's with awesome. A low number.
And it's an Artifacts rookie. Fantastic.
Where's my folder?
Got old school Byron Nelson there.
What day is today? 05.
Shea Revy.
I gotta go get my prize folder open too.
Maria Juntengarn. LPGA. Represented. Oh, nice. How about a big drive fragments from Ben Crane? Very cool. Shirt swatch there. And Francisco Molinari. I think Artifacts is such a great brand for golf. Tom Lovelady. Some guy named Tiger Woods. Hey, how about his niece, Cheyenne Woods, red parallel number to 249. And Angela Stanford. Lori Kane. Artifact rookies, Justin Sue. LPGA, Sue O. Friend of the program, Blair O'Neill. She was an autograph guest for GTS at an industry summit a while back.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Who was the name on that autograph again?
Luke List. Lizette Salas. Brandon Grace. Artifacts rookies. Oh, nice. Danielle Kang.
Oh,
nice.
It's a good hit.
It is a good hit. I gotta at least penny sleeve that. These are true rookies.
You can give me a second to get a screenshot once you have that done.
Card number 78. Good?
Kind of. I don't know why it's really... It's not sharp in the camera, but that might just be unfixable. On my end. So, yeah, and you can move on with opening stuff.
Henrik Stenson. Double. Don't like that. Orem. Maverick McNeely.
Ooh. Cool. I guarantee you that's awesome in person, even though there's no way for the camera to adequately do it justice.
Here, that's a little bit better. Actually, that's a lot of it better.
Well, it's better, but it still is not.
It still doesn't do it any justice. Those are SPs, so we should give that away. Jason Dooner. Pat Perez. Cameron Beckman. Ooh, we got a second. Or Tony Fanu. I'll give both of these and the Danielle Kang rookie to one winner.
Whoa.
That's awesome. There's Blair again. Lexi Thompson, rookie. All right, why don't we do this? We're going to split the Orems and the two lady rookies. This one is numbered 2999.
Is the Danielle Kang numbered also?
It is, and it is much.
No, you're not.
That's a 33?
You're kidding me.
Holy cow. Hold on a second.
What?
We almost blew by the biggest hit. All right, don't take back what I said about giveaway, what we're giving away. We'll sort that out later.
Yeah, they're not getting right Orems with that.
Nope, 99.
We're not throwing any other bonuses in there. Right.
I got my glasses on. I'm sorry. 38 of 99. And it's
that's still incredible. Really,
yeah, I know.
So
it's really hard to see.
Yeah. So
wow.
She's the one from this product that people have been DMing me and saying, keep an eye on, you know, number 4 in the women's tour right now. And this is her first trading card ever. Plus the international appeal, similar to what we saw with Naomi Osaka in tennis, where it's like, you know, people on multiple continents are fans of Danielle Kang. Wow.
Yeah, very cool. The last two cards, just real quick, Morgan Pressel and KJ Choi. Wow. Okay.
I mean, I'm going to try to find – there is – I don't even think there's close to a comp on that yet. The base is going for 80.
Wow. All right. We're going to do – let's see. The Orems with the Lexi Thompson. Okay?
Okay.
So the two Orems –
That makes sense.
And the Lexi Thompson – to 999 rookie. Okay, we go with that. We go Danielle on her own number to 99, the chunky Luke List number to 25, and then someone else gets the Ben Crane.
I mean, that's literally her first card and it's 299.
Wow.
Like, how many of those think will be out there?
Exactly. That's fantastic.
How yeah.
fun.
So I'm actually gotta change the order of these.
So that 4 winners. You got them, bro?
No, I got 3 of them. What was the 4th one?
Okay, we got one Luke List, we're talking about. Danielle Kang, Ben Crane.
Ben Crane. There we go.
All right.
Cool. Got it. Yeah, so I got those 4. I'm trying to work on the perfect.
You take your time. I'll clean up a little bit before, and then I'll talk a little bit about this next product, which I know you're going to want to be paying attention to. So I'll wait. Do you know how much Ivan loves soccer? Well, we've got Topps Museum Collection Champions League. Every box contains one of each card, an autograph card, an autograph relic card, and a relic card. So 3 hits, and you guys know who plays in the Champions League. So there could be some big hits waiting. Ivan, you let me know when you're ready.
I'm ready as soon as our friends that are watching go to twitter.com/goGTSLive in order to enter to win those soccer hits. Golf hits. I'm so confused. There's a helicopter overhead. Danielle Kang out of 99. I cannot believe that. I can't believe we're giving that away. I've got a bid in on the only one that's out there right now. Like, that's how much I can't believe we're giving one away. So yeah, so twitter.com/GoGTSLive. There's a tweet up that you can retweet in order to enter to win. You also have to be following us on Twitter, and you have to be watching at the end of the show when we announce winners in order to win. So do those three things and be right back here, or do those while you're here, depending on how you're watching this, because that's insane.
It's insane.
All right. But yeah, museum collection. This is actually people have been saying the boxes are loaded. Part of it is because the checklist is small. So there's not a huge checklist on this one, which means it's hopefully we'll get some good hits tonight. But if we don't, that just means there's even more out there for all of you when you open it. So very cool to be able to preview this product with all y'all.
All right. Good looking cards, as we should expect from Museum Collection. Started off with a rookie of Ryan Gravenberch. This rookie is a regular base version, not numbered. Ansu Fati, I know you like him.
Yeah, that's the hit.
FC Barcelona.
That's the guy we're chasing. No chance that's numbered, is there?
No, I'm
just
sorry.
The base card?
That's the base. Numbered to 99, we have Yusufa Mukoko.
Who is the second guy that you'd be chasing out of this.
And it's a rookie.
Is there any way to get that sharper? My goodness. Hold it further back from the camera, maybe. Is that just me? Why is it so pixelated? James, is there any idea why that is? Oh, it's like zoomed in so much further than... Gotcha. Okay.
So we'll be giving that away for sure. And then, we're probably going to have to give this card away. How about a Robert Lewandowski red parallel numbered to just 25? So we haven't even gotten to the hits yet, really, and we've already given away two cards.
This is freaking going really well.
Philippe Anderson, numbered 275. Philippe Anderson.
Now, I don't know much about him, which doesn't necessarily mean he's not great.
Also, number 275, we have a kit auto card of Danny Carvalho. Danny Carvalho. Next, we have our relic card, colorful swatch there, numbered to just 50, of Taras Stepanenko.
Ooh, no idea there.
And last but not least, one more rookie card, this one of Jamal Musiala.
Another good rookie card. So this was a great base card pack. Okay on the autos, but great base card pack with the... And that's what I'm talking about. Checklist small enough that you can hit four good base cards in one box between the Fati rookie, the Musiala rookie, the Mukoko yellow or gold.
All right, Mukoko. This is what I'm going to do. We're going to pair up the Musiala and the Stepanenko jersey. So that'll be a combo to one winner. These will go individually. So that's three. And then I'm going to make somebody very happy and just put those together. The Yusufa and the Lewandowski. So four total winners.
Wait, so Yusufa and Lewandowski are different winners, right? Than the Musiala and then Fati with another one?
No,
I can't
see
the pictures because I'm looking at the spreadsheet.
Yeah, no. It's Lewandowski and Yusufa is one.
Someone's going to be really happy.
And then the Stepanenko and the Musiala rookie to somebody else. And then the two autos separately. So four winners. Caraval Auto. And so besides Caraval, who is the other one?
Philippe Anderson.
Anderson. Got it. Awesome. Very cool. Yeah, that Mukako looks like it's sold for $150+. So that's a pretty cool freaking hit. Awesome. Awesome box of Topps Museum Bundesliga. So go to twitter.com.
No, UEFA's league.
UEFA. Oh, gosh.
Bundesliga, UEFA. I think, is next week.
UEFA Museum. Oh, my goodness. Those jerseys got me all thrown off. Yeah, UEFA Champions League. All right.
One more box tonight.
Excuse me. Okay. A little baseball in the form of tier one, two autographs inside, two auto cards and two autos and a relic. Okay. So basically similar format to this other one. Beautiful. Love the old guys. Bat auto numbered to 100 of Jim Rice. That's my kind of collecting right there, baby.
That does look good.
On card auto of rookie Evan White numbered to 300. And also on card and numbered to 300, Gio Urshela. So we'll mail all three of those to three lucky winners.
Evan White Auto, Gio Urshela Auto, and Jim Rice Auto. Did you say that was a bat or a patch?
Bat.
Nice. Awesome. Three winners there. Give me 2 seconds to get the tweet out.
Do you have a second box?
Do you guys mind doing this again?
A second box?
Oh, a second box of artifacts. What? What? Rob's got the rip love. He doesn't want to let it go. He doesn't want to stop it. I like it.
All right, here we go. You know what I noticed? Upper Deck boxes usually have a security seal on them. Both of these boxes didn't have one. It's very unusual for Upper Deck. Okay, guys. I'd like to see one of those sawgrass sand cards. That'd be pretty cool. Jack Nicklaus. Paula Kramer. How about a Danielle Kang, the regular one, numbered to $9.99.
These came from a hot case. I'll bet you the 101 is somewhere in the same case.
Annika Sorenstam. I mean, that is some tremendous three women right there. Paula Kramer, Annika Sorenstam, and Danielle Kang. Natalie Gulbis. She's one of my favorites. Oh, look at that.
Wow.
Lexi Thomas ball marker artifact with the Upper Deck logo on it.
Wow. Is that numbered on out of anything?
No. This is a manufactured golf ball marker. That's pretty cool. That's nice. Why they call it artifacts. So we'll give that Kang away. We'll give that away. Mark Wilson and the great Nancy Lopez. I was running out of decoy cards for shipping.
That's why you wanted
that. Artifacts is always good for that. Alexander Bjork, rookie Adam Hadwin. Some of these guys you don't know about, but you got to pay attention to the rookies in this product. Arnold Palmer.
Now,
David Duvall.
Is that just such an old photo that it's black and white, or is that a parallel that they're doing in this?
That's just... It's like the one of Byron Nelson that was black and white, too. Just an old photo. Michael Thompson. Hey, he was a winner not too long ago. Ashara Munoz. Shirt relic. Harris English.
I don't know. Ripping these cards makes me want them to get sponsors on their shirts so we can get some chunkier patches. So I don't care about the game. I don't care about any of that. I just want chunkier patches for our cards.
Layman. Michael Thompson parallel, number to 249. And Joost Luton. Joost Luton.
Now, I'm confused that parallel to 299 is like fiery red, but the 99
is kind of plain, right?
Yeah.
Stacy Lewis Orem. Adrian.
Is it like a black parallel to 99? What's up with that? I'm on GoGTS.net right now trying to find out.
I put
the or is it that the stuff. Rookies do something different?
Wow! Boom!
Oh my goodness!
And I don't want to give.
He had to turn off his microphone. He's cursing right now. He's cursing that he has to give this away. Oh!
Wow!
No, he's not cursing. He's hunting for protection right now, this moment. Danielle Kang, rookie autograph relic card. Is that a shirt relic in there, Rob?
Dual shirt relic numbered to 149.
Wow. That is crazy. Big, big hits.
Wow.
Tonight. Very, very cool.
Whew. Wow. Look at that beautiful signature. That's just a great card. Wow. Holy cow. David Duvall, Norman Zing, number to 999, rookie, Julie Inkster, and Cheyenne Woods. All right, four winners, Ivan. Actually, I'm going to prize pack this Munoz. Three winners, the Lexi Thompson ball marker, the Danielle Kang, and the Danielle Kang, number to 999.
That's some absolutely insane luck tonight.
Wow. Three Danielle Kangs out of two boxes. A base parallel number to 99, and a rookie dual relic auto number to 149. Unbelievable.
That's super awesome. So thank you, Upper Deck, for sending. I can't believe they sent one, much less two.
I couldn't believe it boxes.
When it got here, I was like,
that's really awesome. Thank you, Chris Carlin and the team at Upper Deck. And wow, yeah, Danielle Kang, number four, as I mentioned on the ladies tour. She's, to me, she's been what I've seen in hobby whispers is like, this is the one to watch out for. So I can't believe that we just did that. So make sure you go to twitter.com/goGTSlive. Check out the tweets on the page. Make sure you retweet. Make sure you're following so that you can be eligible to win. And we've got a few more hobby news segments and updates. And when we get to the end of that, we will draw the winners. And you have to claim your prize if you hear your name called. So you have to stick around for the end of the show to see if you win. Sounds fair, though, right?
Absolutely. Wow. Okay. Exciting. You guys are absolutely awesome as I look and start to update the poll question. Where do you keep your ultimate high dollar value, super mega? This is my HODL for life collection. Stowed away in the dark, 47.6% with 231 of you voting in. A handful of minutes left. So if you haven't, please weigh in. Thank you to everyone for doing so. Let's see what's up next. Oh yeah. I caught a really short video with UFC's Michael Chandler on a recent webcast talking about Panini UFC Prism. So it was pretty cool hearing fighters talk about it on a major podcast. Check this out.
Speaking of new beginnings and being a part of the UFC and what that leads to, I had the opportunity. A lot of people are trying to get their hands on this, to open up a box of the new Panini UFC cards. And there I get a Michael Chandler rookie card.
No way,
look at that,
dude.
Look at that bad boy. Look at that bad boy. How cool is it? Like, I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, there were no Bellator cards, right? Like, is this your first trading card ever? And if so, what does this mean?
My first trading card ever. Yeah. And that is truly my rookie card. You know, I mean, obviously I am not a rookie, but it was my first fight in the UFC. So therefore it's my rookie card. And man, so cool. I mean, just like you, just like every young boy growing up in America, I had the Beckett books and you looked them up. I collected a lot of hockey cards, a lot of baseball cards growing up. And just what a dream come true, because we idolize and we look at all these guys and these players on these cards saying, man, someday I want to do something that will be so significant that I might end up on a card. And here I am 30 years later, man. And goodness gracious, it feels really cool and blessed to be on the Panini cards. And it's really cool. I have one of those myself. And I was going to ask,
you're going to give it to your son, right? You got to give that to your son.
Yep, I'm going to give that to my son. And I got a signed Josefina Benavidez card in my back box of 12. So that was cool. And hopefully I continue to do a bunch of cool stuff with Panini. Hopefully I get a really nice, cool action shot knockout for this next fight. Get another card coming with Panini.
One of the great things about the hobby being so hot right now is it just seems there's never a shortage of content for our show.
Yeah.
You know, case in point, you know, I'm just scrolling. I'm like, oh, check this out, you know? So very cool. No problem. Before we dive into Hot in the Shop, I'll look ahead at next week's new releases. Putting out a call for our GoGTS Live Q&A, but don't get too excited because I've already got it pulled. This one's coming from Pabst Beer 8. Yeah, I wanted to get involved in something he's been talking about, Pabst Beer 8, or Bearded Beer Guy, as you might know him. You know, he writes some of our NASCAR Future Watch driver profiles, and we're going to talk about, we're going to answer a question from him later on in the program. Now, Hot in the Shop. Wow. A lot of things happening in the hobby. New releases coming at a pretty regular clip. Here's what to look for at your local hobby shop, online retailer, or favorite group breaker next week. Ivan, what do we kick it off with?
We're kicking it off with NBA Panini Contenders basketball cards for the 2020-2021 season.
Each box of contenders is going to deliver two autographed cards featuring the top rookies and one of the most popular rookie autograph sets, the highly anticipated rookie ticket autographs. That's right. Contenders is back with a new set, and there's tons of parallels this year, including rookie cracked ice tickets, Optichrome premium edition gold, and then, as you just saw, those clear tickets for the first time featuring hard signed autographs on acetate, as well as tons of various insert sets, including those die cuts, cracked ice, superstars. Check those out. Now, I don't know if those are going to be the rare ones or if the license to dominate are going to be the rare ones, but you can expect that at least some of these will be rare chase autographs or rare chase inserts, as well as the autographs. And there's some ticket swatches this year. So I don't know that in every year past we've seen swatches and contenders with autographs, but there are this year. So check out all of those cool hits. And, of course, you know the rookie class you're chasing. LaMelo, Weissman, Cole Anthony. Who's Thundercats guy?
Anthony Edwards.
Anthony Edwards. Thank you. Lots of great rookies to chase this year, as well as the veterans that you love. So check out Contenders Basketball and Hobby Shops this week.
While you do that, we're going to head from the hardwood to the ice with 2021 Upper Deck Trilogy NHL hockey cards. Checklist is posted at gogts.net as of today. Let's see, two autos or memorabilia cards plus two numbered rookie cards or rookie inserts and two numbered parallels in every box. Very cool. As always, Trilogy once again features a unique 50 card base set and offers three versions of rookies to collect. Recapping that box break again, two autos or memorabilia cards, two numbered rookie cards or rookie inserts, two numbered parallels. The Trilogy 50 card set, those three versions of rookies, include top veteran stars, common rookies numbered to $9.99, uncommon rookies numbered to $4.99, rare rookies numbered to $2.99, and then rookies triple numbered to just $99. Lucky collectors will find rare autograph and or memorabilia parallels of each grouping, highlighted by purple autos for select vets, all the way down to tag patch parallels for rare rookies. Find more rookie cards with rookie renditions and new rookie super stage insert set. Popular signature puck insert sets are also back. A lot more going on and with that manufactured puck with a hard signed autograph. Trilogy also features four amazing hard signed plexiglass inserts to be on the lookout for: autofocus, crystallize, scripted Hall of Fame plaques, and the all new autofocus rookies. Plus, there's triple memorabilia cards and more. Trilogy, where threes are wild.
I don't understand that last part, but you got a chuckle out of me. Since there's no audience feedback, you made me laugh, Rob. Live show, this is what you get. Hey, next week we've got some exciting football cards too, hot on the heels of the NFL draft. We have 2021 Leaf Metal Draft football cards, two configurations, both hobby and jumbo. As if the hobby boxes with five autographed cards per box didn't already have enough for you, this year there's a jumbo configuration with nine autographed cards plus one slabbed 101 autographed card, featuring some of the top prospects from this year's draft class in the NFL, including, you know, the names you come to expect, right? I hit play. I can't hear audio. Justin Fields, look for Najee Harris, Kyle Pitts, Trey Sermon, Kyle Trask, Sean Wade, Travis Etienne, and Mac Jones, among many others in this hot-looking product. So 2021 Leaf Metal Draft football cards in hobby shops this week.
Back to the ice for just a quick second. There is a 2021 Upper Deck NHL rookie box set. 20 sets per case, 25 cards per set. Why did I tell you how many sets are in a case? in case you want to guarantee yourself an autograph. Yep. One box in every case will contain a bonus 26 card, which will be a rare rookie autograph card. The 25 card set includes the top rookie prospects from this year, including number one overall draft pick Alexis Lafreniere of the New York Rangers. This will be in stores next week. Big box and hobby.
Any word on if Kirill Kaprizov is in it, though, as well?
I would imagine so.
Oh, imagine. But we need a checklist. Checklist now. You can tell who among this duo has a case on pre-order.
Do you really?
I mean, they're good 20 bucks a box. It's not that crazy. You know, it's less than a dollar a rookie. You know, throw in the chance at an auto. We'll see. So,
and the chance of an Alexis Lafreniere auto, you're laughing. Well,
that's why I'm curious if Kirill Kaprizov is in there too. It just increases your odds, but not that one of us has a gambling problem. We'll get back to that next segment. 2020-21 Topps Chrome Bundesliga soccer card. So you see, there really is something for everybody this week in the hobby shops. This is going to be awesome. Each box of Topps Chrome Bundesliga delivers one autographed card along with six refractor parallels. If you're new to soccer, you may be learning. If you're old to soccer, you know the Bundesliga continues to cement itself as one of the top leagues in the world, showcasing global soccer superstars and future phenoms. A few of the names that, you know, we just saw a minute ago, Youssefa Moukoko may have his Bundesliga debut in here. But perhaps more importantly, this could be one of your last Bundesliga products to feature Erling Haaland, who is arguably the hottest name in the sport outside of Messi and Ronaldo, and may very well transfer to a club in the Premier League or in the Champions League. So, great checklist, lots of chrome, lots of shiny stuff, all those chrome parallels you like. There is a cool 1 in 36 pack insert called Top 11, highlighting the top 11 goal scorers from the 2019-20 Bundesliga season, as well as Decade of Dominance die-cut inserts. Gotta love seeing die-cut inserts. And do look for base set short prints, including limited cards featuring the Bundesliga trophy, the Super Cup trophy, and the official Bundesliga match ball from Derby Star. So lots of cool stuff to chase in here aside from just the names. Gotta love seeing that in a chrome set. Look for Topps Chrome Bundesliga soccer cards in hobby shops this next week. And that's a look at what's hot in the shop. That's okay. I got it. We're good. It's all good. So, lots of cool things to chase in hobby shops this week. You know, make sure that you're following us on Twitter as well and letting us know. Here's a fun thing you can do. Post your hits if you open some of that product and hashtag GoGTSLivePC so that we see it. You know, there's been a lot of debate in the hobby lately about hashtags on Twitter and Instagram. Well, the whole point of them is to help people see stuff. So if you want us to see your hits, use hashtag GoGTSLivePC. Next up, we have a pretty cool story about a ticket stub super collector. So we don't get to see ticket stubs as much anymore in this digital age. We've seen their values go up on the secondary market. Well, let's watch this video now about a ticket stub super collector. And we'll be back shortly with our Go GTS Live QA.
In days gone by, fans would probably have saved their ticket stubs from that game as a memento, but actual physical paper tickets have become all but extinct due to the pandemic, and we may never see them again. Unless you visit this man's house in Kensington. Julian Delgadio introduces us to a neighborhood all-star who has become the ticket master.
Fox 5 Neighborhood All-Stars, powered by your San Diego County Toyota dealers.
That's how this whole website started. Commercial artwork that was meant to be just thrown away when you're done using the gun going to the game was all meant to be thrown away. Look how beautiful this stuff is.
One fan's trash might be another's treasure.
So I realized, oh, those tickets are cool because they not only get you in the game, but they're like a little keepsake, a little time-stamped keepsake of when you were there and who you're with. And, you know, if you clipped out the box score, you know what happened. You know. This is all my Chargers tickets.
Meet Russ Havens, who's collected ticket stubs for more than 40 years.
Ticket stubs, you have so few of them to begin with. 20,000 people in a basketball arena. And how many of them kept them? How many of them wasted them or poured beer on them? So yeah, the scarcity is what makes it different from baseball cards. And it's attached to a specific event.
And what started as a hobby turned into an online virtual museum at TicketStubCollection.com.
Yeah, I've kind of gotten past the idea of never selling, but I've got a couple I really dig on. This one's kind of arcane because it's an event that is just not that well known. But look at that ticket stub, though.
And it really is a dying art form. Tickets just like this becoming harder and harder to come by, especially now post-pandemic with apps like that.
Tickets are gonna go away. They've been going away gradually for the last 15 years. But now, as with a lot of things, COVID has pushed that right to the edge. I don't think any teams will be issuing printed tickets. Aside from emergency, crappy Ticketmaster styles, really they're not gonna be used. It's all gonna be, show your phone, scan your QR code, and you're in.
Russ started selling his collection 18 months ago, and despite the cynicism towards the ticket industry, it's easy to appreciate its dying art.
I mean, he's like got a donkey kicking the National League team.
In Kensington, Julian Delgadio, Fox 5 Sports.
Some of those older tickets really did have some great artwork. And if you know of an all-star in your neighborhood, please let us know. Visit our website, fox5sandiego.com, click on sports, and then nominate a neighborhood all-star. You can also nominate through our Fox 5 app.
All right. So that was pretty cool. Love seeing stories like that. We're still working to bring Rob into the show, but I'm going to go ahead and talk about the Go GTS Live Q of the Week. I guess Pabst Beer Guy, thank you so much for helping out moderating in chat. Thank you for writing NASCAR Future Watches for GoGTS.net, which, again, if you're new to the show, GoGTS.net is a card website that has checklists, has product information, has sell sheets, has what to expect when you rip. Also has a column on there called Future Watch. So if you're ripping a product you don't know as much about, like a NASCAR product, you pull that rookie card and you say, who is this Elliott Chase? I have no idea. You go to GoGTS.net's Future Watch for NASCAR and you read Brad's column on it, or you go to their Future Watch for soccer or hockey. We get some of the best experts in cards and their respective sports to write these for us. So really great articles. That said, we're co-opting a little bit more of your information today, Pabst Beer Guy, because this is a great question that you asked yesterday on Twitter. So twitter.com/PabstBeer8.
Check.
He wrote, if you got a player's first career home run, what would you do? Keep it or ask something for it? And he ran a poll, and it's easy to be altruistic in what-if situations, but I honestly believe that this is pretty true. Only 8% said they would keep it. 33% said other, and about 29% each said ask for an autographed bat or ask for a signed jersey. So pretty evenly split. I actually voted in this poll, so I was excited to see this question be brought up for us to discuss. I voted other because, honestly, I would just give it. I feel like a lot of players would respond with something, or maybe they may pay forward something else as well. But man, what a story. And first off, the odds of them turning out to be Mickey Mantle or Ken Griffey Jr., where that first career home run is worth $100,000 to $1 million, are actually still pretty slim. So what's wrong with just being a nice person? And instead of gambling on that, and holding that from a young kid, a young guy who just did something monumental in their life, I'd give it back. But lots of great responses on that thread. Lots of great people in the hobby responding on that thread. Just having the chance to hand them the ball, I think, would be pretty cool, which echoes what Pat Pedula said. I just want to personally hand them the ball. So very awesome. Great question there. Remember, if you have questions about the hobby, hit us up with that hashtag GoGTSLiveQA. We will be happy to answer them for you. So that said, should we just
roll on, because I've got a list of winners to announce. Okay.
Okay.
Oh, I just heard him. I just heard him. Did you hear him?
Am I here?
Yeah. All right. All right. That's okay. We're at the tail end of the show, so we'll just power through now that Rob is back. Rob, how are you?
I would keep it. I would, just so you know, I would keep it. I'm one of those people that I would take the long gamble.
What?
I'd take the long gamble that they're the next Sosa, Maguire, Bonds.
There is a selfish person in the hobby, and they are in this room with us right now. We found that one selfish person.
Well, wait a minute. What is the premise? Does the player really want it back? It just says, if you got, I mean, was there a question before this?
How do I run a Twitter poll that only Major League Baseball players will answer? That's what I want to know. Cause I want to ask that question you just asked and get an honest feedback. So I'm going to type that myself and we'll see what happens. So you carry on for 2 seconds. I got to type this up and then we'll do some winners.
All right. So, yeah, I don't know. Like if it's, I know I, when it's a player's first puck scored in hockey, a lot of times you see the players go and get it and then give it to them. All right. So, I mean, I don't know. I think for the most part, baseball players are a bunch of prima donnas and are pretty arrogant anyway. So, yeah, I think I'm just going to keep it and roll the dice that they're going to be like a big deal.
All right. Well, look, I just made it so that only Major League Baseball players can respond to my question because I put up the caveat, only respond if you are a former or current Major League Baseball player. And we know how well that works on the internet. So that's a personal question, though. I asked that from twitter.com/watchthebreaks. Tagged Pabst Beer. Thank you, Pabst Beer, for being our second asset tonight. You are an asset to the hobby, Brad. I hope we can see you in Chicago in a few months. That said, it's time for us to give back. We've given you information. We've given you entertainment. And now we're just going to straight up give back. We have 14 items to give away tonight.
Oh, yay.
Yeah, which means Rob is going to be doing a ton of shipping. So whatever you think about his opinions on the hobby, be grateful. He's doing a ton of shipping for all of you. He's spending his Saturday morning doing this shipping. So if you hear your name called, make it easy on Rob. Make it easy on us. Email us. GoGTSLive@GoGTS.net. The name of the show at the name of the website that we talked about. Email us your name, your mailing address, what you won, and your Twitter handle. Just think, hey, what would I need to mail this to somebody and what makes it easy for them to match it up? And get us all that information. Should be relatively simple. I see some recurring names on here, some repeat winners, some people that have watched the show since around episode one. I also see some new names. So hey, we always got to share that information again. Yep. What, another box? Oh, hey,
it's an Ultra Pro tray.
There you go. I see now. I was looking at my spreadsheet, but if you'd pulled out another box, I would have told you, save it for next week. But yeah, because we got to get out of here. But thank you, everybody, for watching. So starting off with from that first box of Artifacts Golf, we have 2 Aurum hits plus the Lexi Thompson rookie card, which is numbered. Those are going to Adam Davidson, 24. Congratulations, Adam Davidson, 24. The Ben Crane from that box is going to Rick Ellis, 85. Congratulations, Rick Ellis, 85 on the Ben Crane from Artifacts. I'm going to call this the second biggest hit, the Luke List auto patch number to 25. Yeah, I'm that big of a believer in Daniel King. So the Luke List auto patch to 25 goes to New York Loves D-Dub. Congratulations, New York Loves D-Dub. And then that Daniel Kang numbered to 99 rookie. So there's three Daniel Kangs tonight. The number to 99 is going to Nate Dog 5075. Congratulations, Nate Dog. Awesome. Now going to Topps UEFA Champions League Museum Collection. Starting off with the Musiala rookie card plus the Step jersey. Stepnowski, Stepanovsky, big name jersey. It was going to Mibu 22. Congratulations, Mike Mibu 22. The Philippe Anderson autograph is going to at PT Sports 19. Congratulations, PT Sports 19 on the Philippe Anderson auto. And then the Danny Caravel auto is going to Brandon 69. Yep, there's lots of N's in Brandon. Brandon 69 is winning the Danny Caravel autograph. And then the Youssefa Moukoko number to 99 and the Robert Lewandowski number to 25 is going to Susie Corcoran. Susie Corcoran. Congratulations, Susie. I believe you're a first-time winner, and you just got a huge prize pack from Topps Museum Collection. Hey, we've got three baseball hits to give away, three autographs, one of which has a bat relic. First one, Evan White Auto, is going to our good friend Grady Fish and C. Congratulations, Grady Fish and C on the Evan White Auto. The Gio Urshela Auto is going to at AM Zags. Congratulations at AM Zags. And then the Jim Rice autograph bat is going to at Tommy's 54321. At Tommy's 54321. Congratulations. All right. Finally, we had a second surprise box of artifacts with three awesome hits. The Lexi Thompson ball marker is going to be the first one. That's going to Josh Kidwell 29. Congratulations, Josh Kidwell 29, winner of the Lexi Thompson ball marker. The Danielle Kang numbered to 999 base rookie card is going to Levi Nelson. And whoa, that Daniel Kang autograph relic numbered to 149 is going to 714 Sports Cards. Congratulations, Cali Cubs Cheesehead. 714 Sports Cards wins the Daniel Kang autograph numbered to 149. What a show. Packed it in.
Absolutely. It was awesome. A lot of stuff going on. Thanks for holding down the fort there. Well, I think what happened was my cord was tangled up, and I think I just pulled it out of the jack a little too much. I want to give a special thanks to Emily Kless for dropping us a package this week. Obviously, the folks at Upper Deck for hooking us up. Thanks to DJ for joining us from Panini America. Tracy Hackler says to expect a package. And so I can't wait to share with you guys what we'll be breaking from Panini next week. James and I are going to get together, and we're going to host a Twitch subscriber break sometime probably next week of Chronicles Football. So if you're not a Twitch subscriber, you might want to get in on that. One of the great things about when we do these Twitch subscriber exclusive breaks, you don't have to be watching to win, unlike tonight's show. Thanks to James Gale for coming up with a great poll question and holding down the fort behind the scenes. Ivan, as always, all the work that you do. And hey, for you guys tuning in, hanging out with us for a couple hours, you guys have a great weekend. We'll be back with a brand new episode of Go GTS Live, the Hobbies Web Show, next week. And in the meantime, always be collecting, and more importantly, be the change you want to see in the world. We'll see you next week. Bye-bye.